Button up your overcoat when the day is long.
The t-shirt is good.
Okay, ready?
And rolling.
Hey, 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 we're back.
Mike and Al, what the hell?
Hey, 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 this is season 3. If you haven't missed any of our other stuff, go back and find it under Mike and Al, what the hell. Welcome back.
We've been away for a little while because our third
party.
He doesn't like to come on camera, but he's a papa now.
You should see him. He looks 10 years older. Anyway, listen, tonight we got a very special show for you. Cool kills and loving moments. Alex has drawn from the past 10 years, 3 films, 3 great love scenes, and I have drawn from the past 10 years, 3 of the coolest kill scenes that have changed my life forever and will change yours.
In commemoration of the decade that just closed, the 2010s,
Happy New Year. We'll be right back. Okay, let's hit the road running. The first clip is from a 2016 film called The Shallows. Remember that? That shark film? It's directed by a guy named Juan Cole Sarah, I'm probably mispronouncing it, but he's a Spaniard.
That's pretty good.
And it's actually really well done. This particular scene that I chose, Alex, is one of the coolest kill scenes. Why? Because it's so underplayed. Let's give it a look. Just the hand clawing at the sand, and her look. Because you can see her going, and then the music comes in, the strings.
Great composition.
That was incredible. I mean, to me, that's movie making.
And you know, 90% of this film was shot on blue screen.
Was it?
90% of it. And there's always a trick shot in there that they really did shoot on location to make it have that reality.
Unbelievable.
But crawling, you know, see.
And you don't see it head on, you see it. A sconce.
Yeah, so that when he goes like this.
And then suddenly his back end just disappears.
Oh,
and that's all you need to see. Oh, it was a great scene.
Really well done.
Anyway, okay, your turn.
Okay, my turn. So the love scene that I think we should talk about next is from the most recent film, 2019's Queen and Slim, directed by Melina Matsoukas.
Yes.
And written by Lena Waithe. So let's have a look at that.
All right, let's look at it.
What do you want?
I want a guy to show me myself. I want him to love me so deeply, I'm not afraid to show him how ugly I can be. I want him to show me scars I never knew I had.
It was a choice I made in the edit to take their words from the next scene and lay them over this first dance. So it's as if you can feel and hear her thoughts as she's experiencing them in real time.
And I want them to cherish the bruises they leave behind.
And as the song ends and the people around them cheer, the band, it's as if they're applauding their love. This takes them back into real time and they leave together, connected, and as one for the first time in their story.
We should go.
So, what a scene.
Wow.
Beautiful. Because, you know, this entire film, you always feel, every minute of it, that freedom is unattainable.
Mm.
And this is the one moment in this film where they are running from the cops for, you know, a terrible situation that happened, and they're like fugitives, and they end up having this moment in this juke joint.
Yeah.
Really, really beautifully done. Very well filmed. It was filmed in the round.
Yeah.
And you actually feel the hope of freedom for them, especially that the director used a voiceover from another scene where they're talking about their dreams.
Yeah.
That's why I thought it was really, really moving. And it's the one moment in this film where everyone is on their side.
Well, I feel as though just the dialogue, I want a man to show me my scars.
Yeah.
That will love me so much that I can show him how ugly I am.
Oof.
I mean, I've often felt that way, but I've never been able to articulate it.
No,
and
no.
For them to do it in such a way where she's not even saying it, I think it's beautiful. It's just a beautiful scene.
Yeah. It's an extended scene. We just showed you a small clip of it, but you'll appreciate it when you see it. And of course, you know, everyone in that club knows who they are. They've seen the news.
Yeah.
And they know that Queen and Slim have found a safe haven here. And before they have to continue on to where they're destined to be, they have this moment. And so this was one of my favorite love moments from the decade.
Excellent. Well done. Well done. Well, good choice.
Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.
Okay, moving on. Now, we're going to move into the year 2017.
I don't know if I'm ready for this.
John Wick 2, my friends. John
good
Wick
choice.
2. All
good
right.
choice.
Now, here's the setup. In this scene, it's been referenced in part one, but not realized in part one. So
gotcha.
It left you hanging.
That's right.
The Russian mob, let me tell you what it's about if you haven't seen it. Basically, it's about a super assassin who retires and is brought back into action because his wife, who died, sent him a dog as a present just
a
before
puppy.
She died. And then the Russian mob kills the puppy and steals his car, and he goes after them and just kills everybody.
Yeah.
But the Russian mobster who's talking to the guy who stole his car and killed his dog, he says, "You don't know what you've unleashed. This guy killed a guy with a pencil in a bar. He killed three guys with a pencil in a bar." And you go, "Wow, that's incredible." But you never see it in part one. In part two, they refer to it again at the beginning, and this is the part where you see what he does.
Get ready.
So let's run this clip.
Are we? Is this filming now?
oh,
it's so visceral.
Man.
It's.
I mean, yeah. You know what? It's people who don't like violent films don't go see this film, of course, because that's all it is pure violence. But if you're going to have violence, why not turn it into a super opera?
Totally, it's super violence. Very imaginative. It's fascinating to learn that the director. This team, they were the stunt coordinators and the second unit directors on the Matrix series.
Yes.
So they knew.
Stileski is the director.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think they knew what they were doing in terms of how far they could push, where they wanted, what direction they wanted to go. And a simple object like a pencil, who knew? I mean, it just goes right through your head, through your eyeball socket, and out the other side.
And Keanu Reeves is perfect for this role because he doesn't have a lot of lines. Yeah. Well, and you just follow his charisma through the whole thing.
Yeah, he's got a lot of charisma. I always like his voice, too. It's perfect. These genres are perfect for him.
All right. Now, let's move on to the coup d'etat. In 2015, S. Craig Zahler did his directorial and writing debut with a film called Bone Tomahawk. And this film starred Kurt Russell. It also starred Jenkins. Richard, is that
mm-hmm.
Richard Jenkins?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And who else? Patrick Wilson. Is that his name?
Patrick Wilson.
Yes. The thumbnail on this is basically it's a small town sheriff who leads a posse into the mountains because a woman and a guy have been kidnapped from the town by these troglodyte Indians. That is, Indians living up in the mountains that are cannibals that don't even talk. And in this particular scene, they're all been captured by these cannibals, and they begin to butcher them one by one in the most heinous ways.
The Indians, right, the natives, this is actually their land.
Yeah, basically to justify it, what the director did. We'll talk a little bit more about it after, but right now, this is like an ice pick in the eye, so prepare yourself. Roll it.
Now from Gatesville. And they're gonna butcher every last one of these godless beings.
Whoa. Alex.
These are things that forms of human torture and absolutely
I mean,
just beyond the imagination of what a person can come up with when they think about murdering someone.
And listen, this is just one of those scenes that's in this movie.
Just one.
But yay. I'll tell you, the one thing, and we were talking about this earlier, mm-hmm. it's the only way to justify the Indians, because they don't talk.
They're
cannibals. That's what they do their whole life. Mm-hmm. And so people aren't people. They're just like fodder. I mean, I saw a movie, Traffic. Remember Traffic?
Yeah, I do.
The guy just reaches down, grabs a chicken, goes like, and kills it.
Yep.
That's what they were doing to these people. Just butchering them.
So would you say that this is one of, would you say this is the most gruesome moment?
I'd have to say.
Decade? Wow.
Well, no, there's one in Zombie.
Oh, really?
By Lucio Fulci. Uh-huh, uh-huh. That involves a splinter on a door in a woman's eye. It's pretty horrendous as well, but this has to be a
good clip.
In the past 10
good
years,
clip.
My friend. Jeez Louise. Anyway, so that's that. How about, tell us about the next clip.
The final clip that I have is from a film called Call Me By Your Name.
Beautiful.
Directed by Luca Guadagnino. And let's have a look.
You want to set the scene up?
Oh, you want to set it up before. Gotcha. Okay, so our final film, our romantic film of the decade, is Call Me By Your Name, directed by Luca Guadagnino. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to set up the film. This scene that we selected is one shot. The two lead characters are having a conversation around a monument. It takes place in Italy. And you really discover what both of these characters, where their heads are really at.
Are they, they're lovers, right?
They're not.
Not yet.
No,
secretly.
Actually, you know, one of them is a 17-year-old. It's actually, the whole story takes place in his family's home in Italy. And this college student comes and stays with this family as a sort of like an internship. And they end up becoming friends. And at this point, they're just enjoying
adventures
together. Well, the actors are Timothy Chalamet. He's the young 17-year-old. And then Armie Hammer. He's an American college student. Comes in with a lot of bravado. He's confident. And so this young kid ends up kind of admiring him. And they have their adventures. And now this is really the first time where you examine the nature of this dynamic, their relationship.
All right. We'll roll it.
Well, you seem to know more than anybody else around here.
Well, if you only knew how little I know about the things that matter.
What things that matter?
You know what things.
Why are you telling me this?
Because I thought you should know.
Because you thought I should know?
Because I wanted you to know. Because I wanted you to know. Because I wanted you to know. Because I wanted you to know.
Yeah, beautiful scene.
Yeah,
huh?
I mean,
beautiful scene. What I like about it is everything is intonated. You know what I mean?
Yes.
That line he says, "You know what things."
Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
And then he says, the other guy is playing back, saying, "Okay, yeah, but I want you to spell it out."
Yeah.
What I should think about or whatever, mm-hmm. and he says, "You know what I want you to know." It. You know, it's becoming more solidified, even though they're distanced. On the other side of the statue. I love that.
Yeah, they have this huge monument between them. And they're on opposite sides, and yet they're really connecting for the first time. And the whole film is such a sensual film. Everything takes on, you know, everything has meaning, and it gets deeper and deeper and deeper.
Right. And the whole idea that this thing is between them. Get it? It's a metaphor. Yeah. There's a thing between them, and they go out of sight of each other, and the other guy's saying, because I wanted you to know. Because I wanted you to know.
And it's also, you know, two guys, I don't know, you know, neither of them are really great at articulating anything. And the entire film, you know, slamming on the piano, or they're researching at their father's archive sites. There's all these situations where they're together, but they haven't really connected. And so here, their lives like intersect in that deep level, and you feel it. You actually feel that it moved me, the scene. And then of course it goes on, and This director did another film in 2009 that we couldn't include in this series, and it was the same thing. It was Tilda Swinton, I Am Love, and it takes place in Italy. Again, an extraordinary film. So this is his genre, and I think he just made a brilliant film, so that's why I selected it.
Excellent. It was a beautiful scene. And there you have it. So there's our choices. Cool kills and loving moments. Listen.
Six great films from the decade.
Yeah,
make
and
sure
listen.
You see them.
The whole idea of what we do here is just to expand your appreciation of film. We'd love for you to go out and see these films, but we know it's not always possible. But you certainly can rent them. And also, if you're collecting them, go out and find them, because these are gems. I mean, these are films you don't want to... You know, if they enhance your life,
they
right?
They really do. These are stories, you know, I appreciate filmmaking so much because they're stories you just don't get to see anywhere else. Come to the silver screen in such a beautiful way. So take advantage of these films that are out there. You can rent them. You can do what we do. We get together and we go see them. It's an opportunity to see your friends and, you know, go collectively enjoy art. So
excellent. Listen, thank you so much. That's all we have for you tonight. In the meantime...
Remember to subscribe to Mike and Al, What the Hell? Comment and like at the link below.
There you go. Until then, Mike and Al, What the Hell?
You know, we didn't do our What the Hell moments in any of these films.
No, we don't have time.
Okay.
But we'll do it next time.
All right.